hi. Yeah, we're experimenting dead set. Actually, there are three of us. It's only two-thirds, but Erwin, the third person, he really dislikes doing lectures, and we can't really blame him now we're standing here. Actually, this whole lectern thing is kind of new for us. Usually we do lectures behind a table, and then we have space to mess with the paper and have all sorts of drinks on the table and stuff like that. But we saw this and we thought, cool, let's try it out, and maybe we can sort of create a moving target on stage or something like that.
Some dancing.
So yeah, but it's always hard doing lectures. Of course, we're quite nervous. It's a sort of weird trade-off. You go through one hour of hell, but then in return you get to meet nice people and go to nice places and
see new work.
See new work
really
and
nice work.
See really nice lectures. So let's start with it. So. Until a week or so ago, we really had no idea what this lecture should be about. We were thinking about different ideas, different themes, but nothing really clicked. And it's always quite difficult to come up with a good subject for a lecture. For example, how to decide what work to show. We've produced quite a lot of work during the last 12 years, and it's really hard to make a selection out of that. Also, we already described most of our work in detail on our website, so it's quite hard to think of a new way to present our work here, to look for a new angle or a new perspective on the work. And part of the problem is also maybe that we're really sort of typical designers in the sense that we always feel that we have to have some kind of context to react to, some kind of given theme, and usually these conferences are quite open. We can basically do anything we want, which makes us very nervous. So we're trying hard to sort of afford thinking about the upcoming lecture, hoping that the whole thing would somehow solve itself. And actually, it did, because a week ago we were looking at the Offset website and we saw this.
Okay, let's see.
And it worked.
So, yeah, it was announced that Peter Blake would speak, and we were quite excited about that, as we are huge fans of his work. So we were thinking about the fact that he would speak and about the fact that we still didn't have a subject for our own lecture. And that is when we suddenly realized that it might be interesting to look at our own work through the lens of Peter Blake. We thought that this might provide a new angle or the narrative we were looking for. we obviously realize that our work is completely different from Peter Blake's work, and we are not in his league. We work in a completely different discipline, in a completely different context. So, but actually that is what we thought might be what would be interesting about it.
I guess. Especially since it's so different. So.
We hope certainly that he forgives us for using or showing his work and interpreting it like
his work in his way, but it's a good thing that he isn't actually in the room, otherwise we would be even more nervous than we are now. So,
so we selected seven themes from Peter Blake's work, hence the title. Blake 7, and then we try to see how these themes would relate to our own work.
So yeah, to start with, here's a painting Peter Blake made in 1962 featuring the Beatles. It's always an interesting image. The idea of representing the Beatles as four separate portraits, as a sort of composition or juxtaposition of four separate heads, is something that became quite iconic after this painting. You can see it on Let It Be and Revolver, and even Meet the Beatles, early stuff. So, but Peter Blake did it here first, and quite early in 1962, right after the Beatles were formed. It is a really interesting group portrait of the Beatles, expressing both unity and separation. And as it happens, we did a group portrait of the Beatles as well. So we designed this shirt in 2001, so that's almost 40 years after Peter Blake's portrait of the Beatles. Of course, it's a completely different image, but we still see it as a group portrait. And just like Blake's painting, we think that our portrait also contains this idea of both unity and separation, the idea that a band as a whole can be more than the sum of parts. So the cliché goes. So we designed this shirt in 2001 from a Japanese t-shirt company called 2K by Gingham. What we were trying to do here was to design an archetypical band shirt. So we took as a starting point the most archetypical band we knew, and we stripped that band down to its essence, in this case a list of four names. And the ampersands, the addition of the ampersands, that was just a sort of coincidence. The name George was just sticking out too much. So we decided to place the name George as a less one and added the ampersand to the other names to get a more even text block, because a lot of people are always reacting to advice, George, the less name, because most people expect Ringo to be last. And it's poor Ringo. But it's simply to make the text block more even. And right after we made this shirt, we also designed two other shirts involving other bands. And the reason why we did this had a lot to do with the fact that we wanted it to be more about the method than about the actual band. So we thought by showing that we could also use this method on other bands, it would be more about the sort of analytical way how we treated it and not really about this band. But sometime after these shirts were released, we noticed something quite funny, and people were starting to send in images of shirts they made themselves. It started slowly, but it became more and more absurd, actually. We already have received hundreds of them, and close to 1,000. And we still receive dozens of them every month, 8 years after we designed the original shirt. It's really absurd, but we also think it's quite interesting. In one of the, we have to sort of link it back to Blake. In one of the books that we read about him, there was a quote that we found quite interesting. It said that one of the main themes in the work of Peter Blake is the relationship between fans and idols mediated through print. So we were looking at these while we were preparing this lecture, and we thought, well, this is basically also very much about the relationship between fans and idols, and it certainly is mediated through print. It's funny because sometimes we have no idea what these names are actually about, and sometimes we have to Google them to see to which band they are referring or to which phenomenon.
Annie, Frit, Benny, Bjorn, Arne.
Well, we know that one, obviously. But actually, that's the
naked guy.
The naked guy. He is actually naked underneath the. It's a good thing we. It's a good thing we
cropped it.
So right after lunch, it might be a bit too much. So, back to the Beatles, I guess.
Well, there have been more instances of the Beatles popping up in our work. For example, this is a piece we designed in 2008 as a contribution to an Amsterdam art magazine called Sessions. It's a sheet of paper, 17 by 17 centimeters, and it's perforated into little stamps.
Stems? I don't know. What is a proper
You
label?
Say potato? it's actually meant as a LSD blotter sheet. And sheets like these were quite popular in the 60s. You would dip the sheet into LSD and then consume the LSD by putting one of the stems on your tongue. The theme of the magazine was psychedelia, so we thought it was quite appropriate to refer to the idea of the LSD sheet. And the phrases of the sheet all refer to the Beatles' Lucy in the Sky of Diamonds. And we always liked the wordplay of this sentence and the fact that it was referring to LSD, although John Lennon always denied this. And obviously it shows our interest in acronyms and wordplays and codes. So we took the title of a song as a sort of template and we wrote some similar phrases. And this sheet also brings to the next theme, which is rainbows. It's actually the second time rainbows is popping up.
Yeah, it's funny, because Anthony Burrow was also doing it with the rainbows.
But in our work, this is a Babe Rainbow, and it's a piece that Peter Blake created in 1968. And in the outlines that are framing the image, you can see the classical rainbow colors: red, orange, yellow, green, blue, and purple. And since there's not a lot of rainbows to be found in our work, although there is rain on our parades, we occasionally use the full spectrum, as in this piece right here.
Yeah. This is an installation we made in 2002 for an art space called Casco in the Netherlands. We were invited to do a solo show in this gallery, which is quite new for us in a way, because we are sort of hardcore graphic designers, and we were asked to do a solo show here, and we were thinking about how to solve this, and we visited the space and we noticed that it was used more like an office space. It used to be an exhibition space, but the curators were more and more interested in showing art outside of the gallery in the streets, and more like a social art installation thing. And we were actually walking through the space and we thought, wow, this is actually quite a nice space. Let's turn it back into a classic sort of white cube gallery space. And that's when we decided we would have to come up with a sort of iconic piece of art on the wall that would sort of immediately turn it into a proper art space. And we always liked this painting by Elsworth Kelly called Blue, Green, Yellow, Orange, Red from 1966. It's quite a sort of hard edge painting. And we decided to reproduce this painting using colored pieces of A4. We took a look at the proportions of the painting, and we divided it exactly through A4s, and it fitted perfectly. So we could really turn it into a very lightweight sort of paper version of the of the actual painting. So this is the gallery shown from the outside. Actually, there's Erwin on the picture, so he's still there. So that's quite nice. And then the following is just the wall opposite to the work. This was the title. We thought Kelly 101. It's quite a sort of abstract name. When people got the invitation, they didn't actually know what it was all about, because Kelly is also a girl's name. And then, as part of the installation, we also made a publication meant as a catalog. These were how they were showed in the gallery. These were basically the same 150 pages that were also on the wall, but then bound as a book. So it's very much about the relationship between the original work on the wall and the reproduction in a catalog. And in this case, these two were exactly the same. The work on the wall was also the work that was in the catalog on a life-size scale. So obviously this relationship between the original and the reproduction is also quite interesting for us as graphic designers, because we're often working on catalogs, and it's always a sort of challenge to play with this idea that the work that is reproduced in the catalog is just a just a reproduction of the original work and not the original work itself. So by doing it here on a life-size scale, it sort of adds something new to it. And then in 2007, this is the front and back of the catalog. In 2007, we were asked by a gallery in Luxembourg, an exhibition space in Luxembourg, to make something for an exhibition called Ultramoderne. And they asked us specifically to design something about the relationship between rock culture and modernism. And we thought it would be nice to revisit that Kelly piece, especially because it was really a cover version, in the same way that bands cover other bands' songs. We were covering an artist's artwork, so we thought, well, it's maybe nice to revisit it again for this show. So we took a look at the original dimensions again, and we then discovered that we could also divide it perfectly into 12-inch records. So these 100 monochrome sleeves actually together make up the exact
size.
Surface, the exact size of the Elsworth Kelly.
1.5 meters.
Six, yeah. Actually, when we came in that gallery, the space was too small. We went all the way to Luxembourg, so we put it like this against the wall, but we thought it was still quite nice, almost like record crates or something to browse through. And later this piece actually traveled to another exhibition in Brest in France, and there they could mount on the wall, but there was still, it's a really bad snapshot because we weren't there to install it, so you can only see piece on it on the left-hand side. So that is how we originally intended it, as some kind of record wall that you have in record stores, where you walk in and you have this wall of records. But actually we like the one that is standing against the wall much better. So it also shows that you sometimes cannot really plan everything. So what I already said, what we see is basically a sort of cover version, in the same way that bands cover other bands. That was more or less our plan. And we thought that might be a nice bridge to the next theme of appropriation, actually.
Okay, je hebt je water. And here we see a quite recent piece of Peter Blake, a postcard created in 2007 for the Royal College of Art. And it's a composition referring to two artists at the same time, Jack Pearson and Robert Indiana. And in that sense, it's a double homage and paying tribute to two artists at the same time, or two sources. And this particular theme of double homages, I don't know how to pronounce it, is something we explored as well. For example, in this piece. In 2003, we were approached by a Japanese exhibition space called Rocket Gallery to contribute to a group exhibition of record sleeves. And the gallery had asked a group of designers and artists to create work inspired by existing record covers. So in short, we were asked to come up with a tribute to an existing record sleeve. And obviously, the one in the middle is the original. So we took Dark Side of the Moon, designed in 1973 by Hypnosis, which we always thought was quite a brilliant sleeve. Featuring the pyramid in the middle. So what we did was we just added these other two, the square on the left and the circle on the right, actually as a homage to or tribute to Bauhaus, but that might be obvious. So well, also a double homage, I would say. Or something?
Yeah, a tribute to both Hypnosis and Bauhaus. And this is the front and back of one of the sleeves. He produces herself basically using
it's just using actually laser prints.
Yeah. So what we tried to do in this piece was to acknowledge two of our main influences, early modernism and rock culture. Not just in this piece, but in a lot of our other work, we try to synthesize these two together because we do think they're both two sides of the same coin. So, talking about rock culture, we can make a bridge to the next thing.
I'm starting to break out in a cold sweat.
Yeah,
and my voice is like disappearing.
Yeah, we're also
slowly.
Talking much too quickly because in this speed it will be
over in
finished.
5 seconds.
And yeah, it's also not really good. It's always difficult because you write down this stuff, not to actually read it, but as some kind of safety net. And when you're standing here, you're playing with two thoughts. Maybe we should sort of completely improvise, but you're still sort of drawn into the piece of thing and in the piece of paper in front of you. So it's always quite awkward, this sort of balance between reading and looking at the audience.
As well as you first have to actually come here, first finish all the work, to be able to leave and make a new lecture, and then where's the time to actually get into it, into the, so it's quite awkward. Oh well,
but
stuff. On the plane.
Yeah, we were on the plane.
In the hotel last night.
It's also, we're also handicapped because I think we're the only non-English speaking.
And also standing here, hearing your voice out loud. and being confronted with the fact that you pronounce things quite odd.
And the lectern, of course. Although the lectern is quite nice. It would be nice to create more like a moving target on stage indeed, or walk around a bit, or...
But normally when you're just concentrating, you're just working on the object you design. Well, now for a sudden you're sort of the... We think it is about the lecture, of course, we prepared, but all of a sudden you feel quite in the spotlight, to be honest. Okay. Back to the lecture.
This is a self-portrait painted by Peter Blake in 1961. We actually saw this painting in the flesh last time we were at the Tate Gallery, and it still looks very fresh and contemporary. And we always think this is quite a sort of melancholic portrait. You see the sort of young artist in a sort of provincial English setting and already sort of longing to be liberated by American pop culture. It has a very beautiful, melancholic side of it. It's funny when I see it now projected here. It's almost life size. You could sort of...
And also it's good you don't see what we see here, because it's quite of...
It's stretched here, yeah. Of course, in the, yeah, on the computer. But anyway, we realize that this portrait is about much more than just the badges, but still we use this painting to sort of show some of the badges we designed for some previous assignment, just a small selection. We always try to, we love badges, we always try to incorporate them in the projects we work on, whether they're small art projects or sort of larger identity projects. We always try to include them. And I think the fact that we love badges so much also has to do with how both of us, or the three of us actually got into graphic design. We were too young to be actually part of the punk explosion, but we were really interested in everything that came after it, in stuff like psychobilly, two-tone, mod, new wave, that kind of stuff. As teenagers, we were really into that. So how we got into graphic design was pretty much through stuff like record sleeves, t-shirts, badges, and I think that still sort of shows in our work. This is actually the next one. It's actually not a badge, but a design in which we incorporated a badge. It is a book cover we designed in 2006 for a Dutch writer named Jerry Goossens. The book is called Vreeland, and it's impossible to explain the whole novel here, but it's basically about a person that grew up in a pacifist commune in the Netherlands and now finds himself in the war in Afghanistan. So it's all about his sort of changing ideas about war and peace, and we thought it would be nice to take the sort of classic peace sign and then turn it upside down, which is always a sign of the opposite, like the upside down cross or the upside down American flag or something. So, and the other peace, I said peace sign, but I know it's a CND, it's a logo that's designed for a very specific thing, the CND in England. It's, I think, was this in 1958? Mm, I got by Gerald, Gerald Holtom.
You looked it up.
Well, I think it's tonight because you think this is very generic, the peace sign, but it's actually designed by, you know, by an actual person for a specific reason and for quite a sort of specific goal, nuclear disarmament. And it's funny that it's now sort of symbolizes peace in a sort of widest, mm-hmm. you know, in the widest sense. Well, it's actually quite a sort of specific. Specific sign. So, oh, the book actually came with an with its own soundtrack. He had a Dutch artist play the soundtrack to his book. So it came with a little CD that you see on the front. So now, from a badge to a sign.
Street sign, which we think is not a really big step at all. And shown here is a drawing, well, that's not so easy to see, but made by Peter Blake in 1963. And what we find interesting about Blake's work is that in it, topography manifests itself in every possible scale. So we just showed you a self-portrait with badges, and this is a pencil drawing showing American street signs. And what we think is most beautiful, most beautiful in his work is also that he really builds environments with his topography, like landscapes, and that is something that we're quite interesting ourselves. Topography being landscapes. So since we started in 1997, we worked on a lot of different sign systems, and maybe we thought it would be nice to show actually the last thing we did. It was last September, and it is a sign system we made for an exhibition in New York. On an island near New York called
Governor's Island.
And the name of the exhibition was Pioneers of Change. And it was held because of the relation of the 400 years relation of between New York and Amsterdam, because New York used to be a Dutch
forest. A Dutch colony, yeah.
Yeah,
it used
for
to be
a
small
moment in time.
New Amsterdam. And, That whole relationship started 400 years ago, and there was this sort of big, all these events were going on in New York where there were all these kinds of manifestations of Dutch culture, and this exhibition was one of those exhibitions.
And we traded New York for Suriname, which is a good thing, because we eat Suriname food like every other day.
That's pretty, so. Yeah, that is true. We in a sort of... our forefathers, they traded New York for a really small colony in the south, in South America called Suriname.
So it was a group show, and it featured a lot of product and furniture designers, and they showed their work in these officers' houses near a small park. So what we did was using signs that were normally used in places like this.
Well, there were 12 houses sort of around the lawn.
And I think you can see it here better.
And they asked us to, first of all, come up with something to keep all those houses together with the boards over here, over there, which we thought was basically the most rudimentary sign system there is. You know, you walk from the board that says over there to the board that says over here. So we thought it was quite funny. And apart from that, there were, of course, all those boards standing against
explaining what was
porches.
In the houses.
Yeah. Mm. It's funny, they also asked us to come up with the names of all those different houses. Mm. And we were thinking of some kind of system, how we could name these houses in such a way that they also had a sort of relationship with that whole Dutch colonial story. So we used all words from New York that have a sort of Dutch origin. There are a lot of New York names, topographical names, that have their origins in Dutch place names. And for example, Brooklyn, which comes from the Dutch city of Breukelen.
And Coney Island.
Coney Island comes from Konijnen Island, which means Rabbit Island. And so all these, so we came up with sort of 12.
Harlem obviously is Haarlem, and Bushwick, Boswijk.
So all these different houses were also named after this kind of wordplay like things.
And of course, we did also a lot of graphic.
A lot of printers. Actually, the website was also a big chunk of it. It was also a large amount of work. But this is just a collection of the printed matter that we did for that. Misschien iets over het first.
Oké.
Well, we just wanted to show that I was just thinking the wristband. I mean, all these words basically have to do with the idea of distance, of the original meaning of the word pioneer, the person that sets out to explore or to explore land. So it's all about mapping and about exploring land. And so the wristband is kind of funny, I thought, but just because of the nameplay or something. First, because you get this band to actually drink, to be able to drink in the States. They're of course really really nervous about underage people drinking. So they also ask us to make wristbands so that the people over 18 could drink. So we came with first and thirst. And he thought it's kind of funny. But lately I've been thinking, in fact, it was it is also quite because it is so blatantly about colonialism or something. First, of course, we weren't the first there, you know? I mean, they were already the original people, the American, the
Native Americans.
The Native Americans.
Okay. Oh, well, it's all small ideas, actually. But it's really, we enjoy working on large assignments like this a lot, because you start out with a small idea and you can really it's really nice when you can develop it over the whole identity, actually. So yeah, that's actually something we're quite happy doing. Well, but although some of the plans we had weren't able to, we made this image just as
to show some kind of idea to them. We thought the word land was really funny, because you came there with a boat and then you would see land on a sign, and we thought that was kind of funny. But
so what you're looking at is, I think, in the middle of Manhattan, and that is New Jersey, and then over there would be, I think, Brooklyn.
You don't have your laser pointer.
Yes, I got. And then this small island, which you can actually just see from Manhattan, is this Governor's Island, where the exhibition was.
I mean, this board would have been much too big anyway, but there was a smaller board that we designed and that they wanted to get up. But the problem is, this was also a problem with getting all those boards in the lawn, because we couldn't. We were not allowed to dig deeper than 12 centimeters, because they actually told us that there was a danger of landmines, the people, the authorities, and we didn't understand it, and we couldn't believe it at all. But they were more talking about ammunition. It used to also be some kind of army base or something. So apparently there were some exercises, and there were still shells or something in the ground.
But imagine these people living in these houses and all the children playing on the lawn.
On the lawn.
It makes no sense at all. So
we didn't believe it at all. So we were, because actually, first of all, they said that we couldn't use these boards, but we really pushed it through and were really lobbying to get those boards there, because everybody approved of it, the curators, and then suddenly some kind of New York authority came with this crazy story about landmines, and we wouldn't buy it at all. But we couldn't dig deeper than 12 centimeters, and they made a big board with land on it, not that big, but just a little bit smaller. But they couldn't, I mean, they wanted to put it up, but the wind was so hard. I mean, it was storming. It was really crazy, so they had to put it down at a certain moment. Because they couldn't put it really solid in the ground, so it had to be standing on top of the ground. So it was impossible to actually execute this. So, yeah.
I have to stop myself from telling the whole horrible story because there's so much other things that went wrong. But it's just it was only September, so I'm not up to up to telling how it really was, because everything sort of fell apart in the end. But maybe in a year when I'm over it.
not the work, but the whole relationship. Of it was a very bureaucratic assignment. There were different parties involved, different parties of the Dutch government, different sponsors, and they all wanted to. I mean, for example, the press release that we made for this, we worked weeks and weeks on it. Every time they wanted to have another order of the logos and another say, and you just get on and on and on. So it was quite a sort of frustrating assignment.
That's not exactly what I meant, but it's also one of the problems. Well, and also the funny thing was we hand carpeted all the signs ourselves because it was a really, really low budget. We work a lot with really small budgets, so we knew we had to make. We did not understood exactly how this island would be. We've never been there, so how big it was. We had to imagine that, and then. So what we did, we carpeted and we painted like 80 signs. Then they were shipped because we did not have any connection in New York ourselves. So we thought, we have to come.
We did mail some wood shops in New York, but they never answered. Yeah. I guess they were not interested in making 80 boards with over here and over there on there. So it ended up that we all made them ourselves. And
because also it was an island, so we could not come there and be not good prepared, because then we had to go back and forth all the time. So when we got there, we put them all together ourselves, which was actually quite a lot of fun. And the topography, we pasted it on there. It was just a laser print, and we just glued them. It was quite scary, though, because you probably know that the paper, when it gets wet, it gets wobbly, and then you're like, ooh. So, and especially the big boards, they were quite, it took us 3 days, I think.
Building it up,
and then we all had to put them in the ground ourselves.
First, drill in the ground to make the ground loose, because it was sort of hard as a rock.
The things you do just because you have an idea is it is good.
So maybe we should go back to science, or in this case, Peter Blake's science. And this is a very recent work. That he did again is a print from 2006 called The Origins of Pop. And the reason we chose this particular piece is the Coca-Cola logo that is on the right, because here we thought we're gonna stretch the lecture to the maximum, to the absolute maximum, and really push your luck and try to connect this piece with the following piece, only because it both contains the word cola in it. So. That this is a poster we designed earlier this year for an exhibition revolving around the Austrian artist Heimo Sobernich. It was a large retrospective show that took place in a space called CAPC, which is a museum in Bordeaux. And the thing with this particular museum is that they don't have an actual graphic identity. No logo, not even a website. They basically, every time they have a new exhibition, they ask a designer to design the graphic identity for that institute, or how to explain it in good words. Well, the museum is constantly shifting its identity from designer to designer, from exhibition to exhibition, basically. So it it wasn't just a poster for the Heimo Sobernich exhibition, but also in a way the graphic identity of the museum, the temporary graphic identity of that museum, the CIPC. And we were trying to come up with some sort of system that would connect Heimo Sobernich with the CIPC. And suddenly we realized we had no idea where the acronym CIPC actually stood for. Because Musée d'Art Contemporain de Bordeaux is obviously, I mean, would translate into a completely different acronym. And of course, we could have asked them what it actually meant, but we thought it might be a nice starting point for the graphic identity. And we were also looking through some books about Heimo Sobernich and by Heimo Sobernich. We actually visited him in Vienna, and we got a big stack of books. And one of these books was a small booklet called Lexicon der Kunst from 1992. And
this little book was actually just a long list, alphabetical list of words, loosely related to art. And there was no explanation or definitions given, so it was really just the book was just a work by Heimo, designed with somebody So we were thinking about this alphabetical list and about this rather mysterious acronym, CAPC, and we suddenly realized that what we had to do was just use his words to explain the name of the museum. So for every piece of for the whole graphic identity, we used different combinations of words coming from this small booklet. Well, this is the poster you've seen now four times, I think.
There's another time coming up.
Yeah, really? Okay. Yeah. Well, but it's really nice images. We actually never really we never had the time to actually go there for the opening since we had to finish other projects. So somebody else had to make the pictures for us. But that I think they were really nice actually. So on the invitation, we used other combinations: cash, auto, placat, code. This is actually the front of the invitation. Well, it's an
A2 folded like an A5.
Yeah, and the backside is the slide you saw before, which is an A2 poster folded back to an A5 invitation, using different combinations. Although I see the word cola for the second time, I think we thought it was quite important.
Actually, they look like random combinations, and they are in a sense, but at the same time, we did try to get some words in there that would sort of refer to the object they were printed on. On the poster, you saw the word poster, actually. And here you see the card, because this was an invitation card, so we use the word card on the A5, or the poetry thing to sort of refer to the idea of four words together.
And here is the front and the back side of the catalog. Actually, it's not finished, so this is
a dummy. I mean, we were waiting for the text for ages, and it's now finally sent to Bordeaux. I mean, first the plan was that it would be ready for the opening of the show, and we were all set to go, but we were still waiting for all the essays and all the translations, and they didn't come. And then we thought.
And then the opening was already had already been, and then we lost completely all sense of time and orientation because we thought, well, the opening is already gone anyway. So then we were pointing.
And then the closing went by of the exhibition, and we think,
and then
wow,
we were like,
this book will never really come out, but. Then they came with all the texts suddenly, so we finished it off like this. And yeah, Evan is basically now working in the studio on the corrections, probably. Mm. So.
Okay,
Let's stick to letters for a while and then go to the next subject, the alphabet.
And finish it off.
Oh.
How many time we have left? Oh, okay.
10 minutes, we're fine.
Cool.
Oh,
should we do this in slow motion?
The alphabet is a theme that Peter Blake actually uses quite often in his work, already since the 50s. This is quite a recent piece. It's actually a tapestry from 2008. And we're obviously composed out of fine typography. You like these alphabets that he make a lot, because on the one hand it's quite analytical and they're put precisely into some kind of grid. On the other hand, all the letters tell their own story. It's quite anecdotal, so there's a nice tension between that. So now let's switch to one of our own alphabets, which is a film poster we designed for Helvetica, the documentary by Gary Hustwit. The movie was released in 2007, but I think we already designed the poster early in 2006. It had to be ready, of course, some months in advance. The whole poster basically revolves around that sentence, meet the cast. The double meaning of that sentence, cast, can refer to a group of actors and a group of letters. And we also quite like these sort of classic film posters that have these catchphrases like, meet Benjamin, he's a little unsure about the future. Dustin Hoffman in The Graduate, or you know, stuff like that, or Judge, Jury and Executioner, Charles Bronson in, what would that movie be? I don't know.
No idea.
That sort of thing. So we thought it would be nice to try to come up with that sort of sense of this kind of filmic, cinematic feel, but then in the most dry way possible. So we thought that sort of meet the cast thing, this sentence would sort of capture that. And of course, I mean, Peter Blake's poster was found typography. And while we were making this lecture, we were sort of thinking, is this found typography as well? And in a strange way, we think it is, because it is a sort of the language we grew up with as kids in the Netherlands during the 70s. These were the typefaces you were confronted with, and it is something we sort of picked up then and acquired, and we are now using it in our own way. So in that sense, we do think it is found typography in a sort of strange way. So, and on that note, we actually finish our lecture. So.